So let's continue with numerical methods. And I started introducing the Monte Carlo method with a very small example, yeah, from a discrete finite probability space. But actually, that's the whole essence. And I have now an expression that approximates the expectation. So to write that down here, I have that 1 divided by m, take the sum over 1 from 1 to m, z of xi converges to the expectation of z if xi is a drawing according to the probability p, which is part of this expectation. And in what sense do we have convergence? Yeah? So because if I want to use this as an approximation, I will stop at a certain m, and I would like to know how close am I to the true result, yeah, to the true solution, to the limit. A thing that you have to keep in mind is that this drawing corresponds to a single event, omega, of a sequence of IID random variables. And this will leave us with, well, some doubts about the methods, but it will clear up later. So first try. So we know the strong law of large numbers. So if you have a sequence of IID integrable real-valued random variables on the same probability space, so they are all the same, so they all have the same expectation, yeah, and they are integrable, so the expectation exists. Let's call the expectation mu. Then the running average of this sequence, so 1 divided by n, the sum from I to n xi, converges to mu in probability. So we have that there is convergence. So the strong law of large numbers tells us that we have convergence, but the convergence holds only in probability. So you can say almost surely. And that appears a bit useless for us. So what does this mean? So it means it is possible that for a single event, yeah, so assume the single event is a null set, P of omega 0, for a single event, this does not hold. Yeah, so this here. And recall that our drawing is a single event of a sequence of IID random variables. So we have convergence, but maybe the experiment we did, so maybe that path on this picture we had in the previous session. So here, so maybe this path does not converge. Okay, so you can generalize this result, yeah? So there are ergodic theorems that generalize this. So actually you see that in the statement here, there were two different limits or expectations. There is here the, or say there are two different averages. There is here the average over all drawings, And there is here the average over all possible events. And the statement says that the average over all drawings converges to the average over all possible events. So this average over all drawings is sometimes called the time average. And the average over all events is sometimes called the space average. Okay, and the ergodic theory states that under certain condition, time average and space average are equal. Issue is that we like to use this as an approximation and we do not really gain anything from this. Next try. There is the central limit theorem. Assume we have this IID real valued random variables. And we assume that we know the expectation, it's mu. And we also know the variance, it's sigma squared. Then we have that the limit of the running sum of xi minus mu divided by, and then not divided by n, divided by square root of n times sigma. So this is somehow how much do we stay away from the expectation. So is why is that? So let's try. Okay, so I have here the expression 1 divided by square root of n sigma sum xi minus mu. Okay, and then this thing here looks at what are bounds A and B for this difference. So what are bounds actually, maybe error bounds. So what are bounds for this difference? So this should be in between A and B. Okay, so what's this expression? So first thing is I multiply with square root of n times sigma. So I have here multiply with square root of n times sigma. Okay, then times a, and also on the other side. So I have square root of n times sigma times b. And then in the middle, I have that this stays between the sum I from 1 to n xi minus mu. Okay, then let me divide by n. So if I divide by n, I get here a divide by, square root of n, because square root of n divided by n is 1 divided by square root of n. So I get something like that, square root of n. So I have divided by n. So I have here 1 divided by n. And taking the sum over mu and dividing by n is just mu itself. So I can make here a bracket around this. Yeah, so the mu is not part of the sum. This guy here, of course, is no longer there because it has canceled. So I can move this a little bit. And you see that this stuff, which is in the bracket here, in the bracket of this little p of our probability here, this stuff is actually the difference of the object that is of interest to us. So our time average, our running time average, 1 divided by n sum xi, the difference of this and my mu, so the value that I like to approximate. Okay, so this here is the this here is the error. Okay. And you see that the error is staying between two bounds. So these are error bounds. Where the bounds become smaller and smaller. Because if n is becoming larger, this becomes smaller. So you somehow already get a feeling here that you have a convergence rate that somewhat corresponds to 1 divided by square root of n. Then the central limit theorem tells us the probability that we stay within these bounds. We still do not know the convergence rate because the result holds only in the limit. Okay, so an issue is here that there is here this limit n to infinity. So this holds for n to infinity. So although we get some intuition that 1 divided by square root of n may play a role, we still do not know the convergence rate because the whole theorem considers n goes to infinity. So actually, I would like to have an estimate for a fixed n. I would like to have an estimate, what is the error for a fixed n? So I like to have an error estimate for a fixed n and not something that involves limit to n to infinity, so that it holds at some huge number which I cannot achieve. But there's a guy that gives us this, which is the Chebyshev inequality. So next try, Chebyshev inequality. So maybe you remember that. So let x be a square integrable, denote a random variable. Then if you know the expectation is mu, and the variance, say the sigma squared, is also given, then the probability that x deviates from the expectation, so which is our error, by more than epsilon, is smaller than the variance of x divided by epsilon. Very quickly, a sketch of the proof. Assume that we have a density. So assume that we have an absolute continuous random variable for which we know some density phi. Okay, then the proof is very easy. So the variance of x. So this is the integral x minus the expectation of x squared integrated phi x dx. So, okay, then you can cut out a certain part. Let's cut out the part where I'm fine with everything. So I'm cutting out x minus expectation is less than epsilon. So I'm just integrating over the error part. Okay. So I'm just integrating over x minus e of x, expectation of x larger than epsilon, x minus expectation of x squared phi of x dx. So the x squared, of course, on the outside here. So this is the stuff under the integral is positive. So if I cut out something, this is making the stuff smaller. And then you see if you cut out this something, this stuff here is larger than epsilon. So this stuff is larger than epsilon. If you include the square here, it's larger than epsilon squared. So you can make the stuff even more smaller if you just integrate now over epsilon squared. Okay, and then you see you can take out the epsilon squared and integral over the density is just the probability. So you have that this is just the probability times times epsilon squared. So the probability of what? The probability that we stay away from the expectation, yeah, so that we have an error. Okay, so now you can rearrange this to get the result. Okay, so why is that guy helpful to prove now the convergence of our Monte Carlo approximation? So the convergence of this 1 divided by n, the sum of xi. So a small remark here. So that is in the slide, the proof. Okay, just what I wrote by hand. Now a little bit nicer with LaTeX. And you can generalize the result to LQ, yeah, and get this estimate. What can we get from now this estimate for our problem that our time average xi approximates the space average, the expectation. So I use now this result. So I have the result that the probability that x minus mu is larger than epsilon, this probability is smaller than the variance of x divided by epsilon squared with x is equal 1 divided by n sum I from 1 to n xi. So I just plug here this guy into this equation and note that the expectation of this random variable. So I use the whole result with this random variable. So with the random variable that is the sum of these IIDs divided by n, the expectation of this is just 1 divided by n, the sum of the expectations. This is just mu. Yeah. So it's the same mu. What is actually the variance? So because now here on the right-hand side, there is the variance of x. So it's the variance of this object here. Yeah, so whenever you have now an x inside, yeah, so there is expectation of x, you have to place this sum. So what's the variance of this sum? So the variance of 1 divided by n, the sum of xi. So first of all, I can move the 1 divided by n in front. Yeah. So the variance is the expectation of the squared. So this is 1 divided by n squared, the expectation of this, the sum. So this is the variance of the sum. And then I have that the variance of the sum, or maybe I do this in a separate step. So I have here the variance of the sum. So the variance of a sum of independent, so now it's important that they're independent, random variables is the sum of the variances. So I have that this is the sum I from 1 to n variance xi. So this is then all the variances are the same. Let's call all the variances sigma squared. They are the same because they are all identical. So let's call this sigma squared. So I have n times sigma squared. So I have a sigma squared divided by n. So this is a sigma squared divided by n. So now I have calculated all the things that are part of here my Chebyshev inequality. This expectation is just the same. It's the mu. This here is my 1 divided by n, the sum. And this here becomes sigma squared divided by n. So I can plug it in. So I have the nice result that the probability that my sum, and you see there's now no limit n to infinity involved here. Yeah? It's a fixed n. I have this calculation done for a fixed n. So 1 divided by n, the sum from 1 to n xi, the probability that this deviates from my mu by more than a certain error, this probability is smaller than sigma squared divided by n times epsilon squared. That's a nice result, yeah, because now I have really a convergence bound. Yeah, I have a constant, a certain constant here. Oops. Divided by n. Well, maybe it's not in the form that I would like, because here the probability that I'm staying outside this error bound is getting smaller. Maybe I would prefer that I look at a fixed probability. So I would like to have the probability that the result is accurate of 99%. And then I would like to know how much does the range become smaller. So actually I would like to have the n rather here than there. Delta should be my confidence level. So delta is the whole right-hand side, sigma squared divided by n times epsilon squared. So if this is my delta, then the stuff that is here inside also gets the variance. So the stuff is here, the sigma divided by square root of delta square root of n. So you can rearrange this in a different form so that you prescribe here a certain probability delta, and then you have that your bound is sigma divided by square root of delta. So if you have a larger probability here, you get a smaller bound here. Yeah? But this bound becomes smaller as n increases. Okay, so that is now the summary. Yeah, so I have proven the Monte Carlo convergence rate by plugging in this sum into the Chebyshev inequality. So, and here are just the two forms which I derived. So the form with a fixed given bound epsilon, and you get that the probability becomes smaller that you are outside this bound, or the form with a fixed given probability, then the range that you are in becomes smaller, like 1 over square root of n. So maybe the third formulation is the one that's even more interesting, to take the probability that we are in a certain bound. So this is what we truly understand here as convergence. So the probability that we are in a certain bound, so that we are smaller than sigma divided by square root of delta square root of n. So this probability is larger than 1 minus delta. Yeah. So I have the statement that the probability that we are within this bound, which becomes smaller and smaller, is larger than 1 minus delta. So the convergence rate is 1 divided by square root of n. An issue is that this holds only in a certain probability. So this leaves us with a little bit, maybe a few doubts, about the method. I will clear these doubts up later. But the result here means that most of the paths, so if you think back of our picture with the paths, so when we started here, most of the paths with a certain probability, that is most of them, so some of them stay within the bound, within the given error bound, but there are some that are outside. And what's a bit bad is that we were using the sequence of IID random variables. So we are using here this sequence of IID random variables to model drawings from a given random variable X. And the drawing is just a single event. So that leaves us with a little bit of bitter taste here with this method. But as I explained, I can show you in one of the next session that this probabilistic nature is not a bug, it's a feature. It's a feature that enables a certain property. The dimension of the probability space does not enter here in this convergence. So the convergence is the same, even in high dimensions. And the only impact of increasing the dimension is that it maybe takes a little bit more time to generate the sequence, but it scales linear in the dimension. And that's really a very big, important property. So, last remark, note here that in contrast to a classical convergence estimate, so we have an estimate here that holds only in probability, but I will come back to this later and show you that it's actually the feature that enables that the dimension does not enter. Thank you. That was it for today. Next session will be Monte Carlo integration. So you can use this to calculate complex high-dimensional integrals.